less, yeah, of that committee. I'm Councillor Daniel Cribbin. I've taken over from Councillor Diana Osborne as chairman, as Diana Osborne resigned, or stood down from the council as of May this year. So I'm now the host as the chairman of this committee. So welcome to everybody. And I'll go through, and hopefully we'll be out of here quite quickly tonight. But if you, anything you need to discuss, feel free to do so. I'm not going to rush you through, just if you've got things to talk about. Housekeeping, since we're not expecting a fire alarm tonight, so if the fire alarm does go off, that's the fire exit through there, that's outside stairs, or back through the door we came through. But I think probably that's the more suitable one. Nobody with disabilities in here that can't walk downstairs, so that's good. Right, okay then. So also mobile phones. If you've got a mobile phone with you, make sure that it's switched on to silent mode or to auto not. We have a rule, I think, within the council that if the phone goes off, that's a donation to the chairman's charity. So if you don't want to put some money in charity,
I think it's
£10. It's £10, yeah. Isn't it? Yeah. And it's no good charity, actually. This year it's the Macmillan Nurses, but so it's a good charity anyway. So
we should phone back on this.
Great. Okay. So moving on to the first item on the agenda, minutes from last year's meeting held on the Tuesday, the 9th of June 2016. Okay, so everybody had a look, chance to look through them. Are you okay if I sign those as a true and accurate record of the meeting? Are there any amendments that anyone wants to make to them all? No. Okay, we'll see what these ones in here are signed. On to item two, any apologies for absence?
Apologies received from Stephen Mullins, Chair.
Okay, and declarations of members' interest for item three? No? Okay. And item four now then, annual review of the standards of conduct and complaints handling. So,
yes, thank you, Chairman. I remember who's been on the committee before, obviously some of the parish independent members have, and those members will know that the work of the committee should be really outside of a meeting like this. It's with the hearing panels and the like, but we have had many in the last year or two. But the committee itself tends to be reviewing and is rightly looking forward to suggesting development opportunities and development needs to respond to for the coming year in particular, based on what's happened. So it is like an annual report, informative hopefully for you to be able to make a judgment as to, right, do you think the recommendations put forward are sensible? Do we need to do these things? Or was there something else that's happened, perhaps since the report was written some 3 weeks ago now, that perhaps suggests, okay, we need to do something a bit more enthusiastic on subject X. So it's a wash-up, general review type report for those who go with what normally happens. And under the Constitution of the Council, I need to make sure the committee has produced, if you like, an annual review, and this will dovetail into that purpose. So that's quite good. What I can say to you is that we are compliant with the legislation in terms of what's been happening in the council, and we've been trying to assist with parish councils as well, in particular e-learning. Normally we don't have to do that, but we try to do that, and we reckon that's good practice. It's all in the interests of local government per se, to have councils overall behaving well. So you have a role as a committee in respect of making sure there's good standards of conduct and your promotion of that, hence some of the recommendations, whatever you decide to do on those. You also have roles, potentially those hearing panels I mentioned. And I have a role supporting you and also then assisting members of the council and officers of the council in understanding what needs to be done, and then assisting the parish councils as well in that discretionary way that we've identified as appropriate. If I deal things section by section, I'm unconscious, I'll say at this point, I have discussed with the chairman. The chairman's happy that if I deal with the reported sections, so I'll go for like 4.1, 4.2, 4.3, and the chairman will invite you to have questions and comments at the end of each section. because we do have two people at the back as members of the public, essentially, but they are, so you're aware, because we don't normally get members of the public attending these committees, as you know, they are independent persons, and what they've said to me quite fairly, and it's for them to decide, but they want to be, seem to be so independent, if you like, is that they do not want to be a party here when that conversation on independent persons, in particularly remuneration, is being talked about. And so I think they're going to leave at that point, so you might wonder why they're suddenly that. And I'll explain that issue when I get to it. But hence, perhaps doing things in sections, so they can see what's going on. And part of the role of independent person is to give some credence to council's processes that they are genuinely independent. So it's good for them to be here. So I welcome their attendance, and I've encouraged it, to be perfectly honest with you, just so you're aware. Okay, as a precursor to the information section and section 4 on page 8 of your papers, nationally there haven't been any changes to the standards regime. There was some talk of a revisit of sanctions, because that's the weakness, frankly, of the current system, is the effectiveness of sanctions beyond reputational damage, which is the main and always a big. There was talk on the back of a case, Saddleworth, of government review of sanctions. That hasn't happened, and quite honestly, I don't think it will happen for some time, if at all. The Committee of Standards and Public Life has always been concerned about that aspect, and was due to be taken up the issue a bit more forcibly than has been the case to date, but actually that's been put back as well because of changes to their work programme, and also because of the general election got away from their perspective as well. But the relevance of their work is that whilst they set the tone nationally for keeping the government under watchful eye, is that we as a group of monitoring officers in Northamptonshire have written to chairman of that committee to say, look, we are bothered about the limited effectiveness of sanctions as monitoring officers. The committee in the past has also had that kind of view, but we have written as officers in particular, and we invited the chair to come and visit us, and they were going to come and visit us, and they still potentially will, but it's been delayed, as I said. But that's basically what's been happening on the national scene, which obviously is not a lot. So nothing needs to have changed in that sense. So coming to 4.1, so the first section I'll deal with, and then share my questions as appropriate. We've been trying to, as a council, make sure that people understand what's appropriate under code of conduct expectations and requirements through the police themselves, and offered ourselves for advice and contact. And I particularly have that role to play, and I've had most contacts about disclosure of interests and the like. Heard has been quite an issue this year because we've had three elections in the past year, very relevant to people. And I mentioned earlier about officers wanting information. So it's not just members who get information, it's officers, and I include clerks in that as well. So I get quite a few contacts from clerks about what's the right thing to do. When there is an election, as there was for district council by-election this year, I have a role in briefing the new members on expectations under code of conduct, and that was done in this case. We had a new member, Councillor Lumley, and he was duly briefed, and he's duly submitted his register of interests. There haven't been any parish or town council elections as such, but there have been co-options, and one of the issues for me is making sure clerks help get those co-opted members to also submit their interest disclosures to me as monitor officer, because that's a bit harder for me to track if I haven't been alerted by an election process. But I'm getting information through, so I'm hoping the message is getting through. And with all the code of conduct territory, all of the standards territory, the onus is on the individual member. So it is for them to get it right. But we're there to try and assist. And you'll see I've recommended 2016-17 key messages, as we did in the previous years. And that would be, I suggest, one of the things to put in the key messages. Remember to get your co-opted members to complete their interest forms. In this section, I also refer again to the role of Northamptonshire County Association of Local Councils, NCALC. They've been very useful in trying to assist in promoting our standards of conduct and good governance procedures in general at parish level. And that's helpful for me, and I think it's helpful therefore for the council here to know that there is some support from the parish's own body. Because most of the issues I get are from parishes. inevitably so, there are 53 of them, so inevitably so. But it helps manage the promotion of high standards that we as a council decided it's appropriate to do for parishes as well as for ourselves. There have been some mystery shots, which I've mentioned twice in the report, I've noticed since I've come back to read it up again. There have been three mystery shots, two by independent members of the committee and one by an independent person. And they were chosen because of some issues in the past, but feedback was positive as to what those people saw. And I think it's still a useful tool to have, and it's again the recommendations I've put forward. There was a code of conduct session that we put on for DDC members, involved an external facilitator, and had 24 members attend. That's excellent number. Please don't think 24 members means we've got a problem, therefore you know, everyone's attending. It shows there's interest in the subject, which is right for them to have, and it shows that it's always good to share experience from outside, and that's the role of the external facilitators to bring some other case studies to bear and to show what happens elsewhere, which I can do to an extent, but the external person can do to a greater extent. So that session was useful, and I suggested in the report that it'd be wise to have some such session again, particularly picking up interest disclosure, which always comes up. Also about behaviour, what constitutes disrespectful behaviour, because I get a bit on that. And also this TURDA issue, because next year there will be district council elections proper. So TURDA guidance for the game seems to be relevant. I'm on the top of page 10 now, so I've come to the end of this section. So I've mentioned about mystery shoppers. What I was interested about this particular paragraph was that one of the mystery shoppers, one of our members therefore, reported that one of the councils had put the general principles of public life on the wall of the parish meeting, which I thought was quite a good reflection of their commitment to the theory of the code of conduct, and I hope it actually is practiced routinely. And it was a mystery shop, so I don't think they would have known we were coming. Sometimes they can find out, of course, but they might recognise that person or whatever. But I don't think they knew. But it was good that I forget which member it was who did that mystery shop, by all means confess later. But whoever it was, they recognised that that had been put on the wall, which I thought was quite interesting. And the other thing, finally, in that section is I've subscribed to the Standards Exchange, which is a kind of a national forum where we can exchange views about what's happening with our standards, which is quite relevant these days because we've had a limited amount of business, which is a good thing. But we used to go try and to keep in touch, obviously, and try to stay afresh and ready to respond to something that might come up. So that exchange has been useful, and it also has the side effect of reduced fees for investigations, of which you'll see that I might mention later that there have been two in the past year. So that's on the general topic of high standards, before I get into more detail into the code of conduct.
Thank you, Simon. So as Simon alluded to, we're going to take each point as it comes, and we have a quick discussion and debate about each point if we have anything. Any points you want us to raise, it doesn't have to be debate, it can be just information or comments you want to make. So with regards to 4.1 then, I'll throw it open to the floor.
Just one question. I think this mystery shop is very excellent, but could they be used as well, or is there a process in place to use them for a full council meeting? Because I'd be very interested to have somebody observe a full council meeting randomly during the year and have their feedback on the conduct and how it went.
You're suggesting parish council meetings?
I'm talking about our own.
Or our own council
meetings. I'm talking about our own. I think that would be a really worthwhile exercise. Yes, and sometimes we don't see what goes on. Because you're so involved in that moment, you may not be aware of the whole ramification of what happens sometimes. Appreciate occasionally it's heated, but heated in the right way, hopefully. But there are moments where you wonder if somebody else who had an eye on it is able to see what's going on would have a different view of that.
Yeah, yes, it can be done. No problem with that, and I can make the suggestion.
Just trying to be practical.
Follow the suggestion. What we've done in the past is picked on those councils where we know that there have been some issues.
Sure.
But that's not to say we can't apply to others, and including ourselves. So no problem with that. The question might be, do we pick, say, a committee in particular? And I can think of, for example, planning committee is always the interesting one, the contentious one. Yeah. That might be useful for someone to observe anyway, as a matter of interest, rather than just for a standards purpose. So you can take that on board, Chairman.
Just a thought.
Yeah,
that's good idea. Thank you. Anybody else want to raise any points or comments, etc.? No? Okay, well, we'll move on to the next point, 4.2. Okay. 4.2.
This is fairly short. What I'm pleased about in this section is that 51 out of the 53 parish town councils have adopted a code. It's basically the same as ours. That makes it a lot easier to argue the voice. There are two that follow a different code, which is hasn't given me an issue to date, but could do, but so what? 51 out of 53 is an excellent ratio, not a problem. We haven't had need to make any adjustments to what we have at DDC, which is some of the local codes we have on planning, licensing and housing. So we haven't had anything that needed to be done on that. What I have done, which is relevant particularly to DDC members of the committee, is I have drafted a revised code of conduct for employees, which went to strategy group last week, has been recommended onto council, which is the end of the month, and it builds on the same sort of principles, general principles of public life, and has similar provisions as you would expect of members. It also goes into a bit more expectation as well, because they are employees, and therefore there's a bit more direct obligation at times. But it's trying to have synergy, and we already have a code, so it's not a new code, it's a refreshed one, trying to have a synergy in the way it's also presented with the content. So that's been put forward, and the relevance for the PC members of the committee is if we get hearings of appeals by employees about dismissal, then it's relevant when we have a hearing panel for that purpose. And that's only intended by DDC members. Dispensations is always available for members, but I've had questions asked of me as to whether a dispensation is likely, and in the cases that have been put to me, I've said, frankly, no chance. And it's for me to grant. Most of the time they know the answer's coming. Feel obliged to ask the question. But there are a couple, and there's one, for example, to live now, which I will grant, which is a straightforward one, as we previously granted. The point about it is, we don't get many requests, which I think is quite a good thing, because there could have been a risk when this was originally devised that people were trying to apply for dispensations like confetti, trying to, you know, get around the system, if you like. But no, people don't tend to want to do that. Accept it, okay, fine. We'll just deal with code of conduct as it is. So nothing much has changed on the code of conduct. Some news on the employee side.
Okay, thank you. Is there anybody who'd like to add any points on that point?
I think I just want to say, I think for a parish clerk, if heaven forbid they had to do a dispensation, I think it would be very difficult for them to judge.
Yeah,
it's one of the very quirks of the new system. Rests with our parish clerk to issue a dispensation.
It could rest with the clerk, it could rest with the committee, it could rest with the full council if it wanted to. So it's up to the council. I deal with the requests for DDC, and you rightly say, a parish level deal with the parish requests. I do get contact from clerks frequently on whether such somebody should apply for
one.
I say, it's not worth them doing it. And they probably relay that message. Sometimes I get it direct from the parish council. But you're right, there is an expectation at parish level which they weren't really trained for, necessarily equipped to do. But I think they've learned over time, to be honest.
Yeah.
Because it's been a few years now. But okay. I don't suspect they enjoy it.
No. But I mean, they can always come to you and ask for advice.
Yeah.
And then go to NCAL as well.
And then go to NCAL to get advice. But they're more like on that one, they would more likely come to me. And they can use me as a shield if you like, quite right.
Do they all realise they should, can and should come to you?
Yeah, because dispensation did feature in previous messages, the key messages that talked about. Because in the early stages, some councils hadn't appreciated that they were the ones to decide on those. They thought I was still doing the call, but no, the call does not allow.
Okay,
top.
Okay, move on to the item 4.3.
Yeah, key topics then. So I've given a hint of this. So disrespectful behaviour, interests. The other one that's come up times predisposition versus predetermination. So I'll use a planning scenario because that's where it normally comes up. You know, somebody's been known to have had a view about something, a view about a proposal, thought, well, it might be a good idea, or, oh, that looks interesting. And then somebody's thought, that's actually fetching their discretion later. They've come to the preconceived view already, and if they've come to some support for it or objection to it. Whereas the test is whether in simple terms, they've got a closed mind when it comes to the actual point of deliberating and deciding. And to say somebody is absolutely closed mind is very difficult to do, very difficult to prove. So people, I think, some people expect councillors to be robots without any ability to have a view before they get to a meeting. That's not human, is it? And that's why there is a distinction, if you like, in simple terms, between predisposition and predetermination. You must not be predetermined. You must not have a fixed view that you cannot change when you go to make a decision. That's just biased proceedings and puts the council at risk, the decision the council is. Also, potentially, clearly, means the council comes into disrepute territory, so it reflects on the code of conduct. But predisposition, have an initial view, but caveating it, saying, look, yeah, I think that's a bad thing, but I'll just wait to see what officer said, or wait to see what the consultation said, or wait, whatever. That's okay. It's a difficult one at times to get across to the general public, I find, more than to councillors, officers, or grant. But be aware that's out there, and it's something we'll pick up in training, I suggest, for DC members in particular. Just to say, I know NCAL do their own training sessions for the parish. One of the things I've highlighted here in terms of key topics is social media. And we did pick that up in the training session last time, but it's going to be an increasing issue. So hang on a minute. Is a councillor, when using social media, outside of a meeting in particular, acting as a councillor or not? Because that's the first question you ask about code of conduct, it applies. Are they acting as a councillor? And social media territory is a tricky area, and there have been some interesting cases on that, including some capture, which have gone to the Information Commissioner's office. So that's one that's very useful to share experiences from other places in that external training session. But social media guidelines we have issued, and I always say to members, make yourself aware of those, because in your defence that will help you if you go astray, for example. And I've mentioned about code as being a key interest. And for me, it's a good thing that people are asking, because they were concerned to be doing the right thing. And I put it here, actually sometimes people are being overcautious. Because I'm a great believer that members are there to do a job. They're there to represent people. They're not there to be kept quiet. And the code of conduct is not meant to keep people quiet. It's meant to just guide you and do the right thing, but do it in a fair way. So these queries about, am I breaching code of guidelines, essentially it's guidelines, are very helpfully to me, and I hope to you, reassuring you that members are just concerned to get it right, particularly at a key time, which is an election time, when it's really testing credibility of people. So I think that's a good thing that PERDA has come up to the topic. Yes, there were three elections, if you like, or one was a referendum, two elections, which may be particularly resonant, but it's one that does come up every year. The volume was a great issue. But let's do it again. Let's do some work on that, because it will come up this year. So I pause there, Chairman, because interest, disrespect for behaviour, predetermination, etc. are quite routine. Social media is increasing. PERDA has been topical, but will continue.
Thank you. Yeah, definitely. Social media seems to have really taken off in the last few years, hasn't it? And it's so easy to ping an email or contact on Facebook or anything like that. You just have to look at what the President of the United States seems to be doing all the time. but you have to be very, very, very careful what you do. You do actually put out there into the ether, as it were, because it stays there forever. And that's usually where a lot of people actually fall down when you see what goes on and you read everything in the newspapers that has been coming forward in the last year or so, but it's usually social media that so it tends to trip people up because it's so accessible, you can easily do whatever you want, whenever you want, any time of the day, and you might have had a hard day and you're feeling a bit frustrated, you might fire off a message or you might have a drink or two and you do the same, and it's then you regret it later, so that's something that everyone has to be very aware of. And I know with PERDA, it's something that is very, it's sometimes misunderstood by councillors, as you alluded to, the fact that it doesn't mean you can't say anything within that period, but you've got to be very careful that you don't try and promote the council
greatest issue is on that is the council has got to be very careful about what it publicises. Mm. That's where the restriction really kicks in. The individual council can go off to the media if they want to do, say what it wants about things, essentially. So it's not a difficult area, but as I say, it's good that people are asking the question.
Mm. Definitely. Well, it is good. I mean, say as chairman of the committee, it's actually encouraging to see that people are asking questions. It means they're taking it seriously. Doesn't mean that there's a problem out there. It means probably quite the contrary, actually, that people are aware of what they should do, and therefore they're less likely to fall into traps. Because it's a complex set of rules out there, and people can easily fall into a trap without even realising it. They're quite innocently, and they get themselves into trouble. As everybody in this room is a volunteer, effectively, you're not doing it out of necessarily the love of doing it. You're doing it because you want to put something back into the community. So you're out there doing a job that you feel you want to do a good job. And you're not going to do it and make mistakes unnecessarily. So it's a good thing that we are beginning to be able to call. Okay, so any points? Yeah, Councillor Helen.
Can you just refresh my mind with the acting as councillor with social media? So if you've got a page that's councillor whoever, is that a new postings but you're using that, so it says councillor such and such says this statement, is that acting?
Most likely, most of the time you would be.
Yeah.
It'd be hard to think otherwise. Sometimes it's when people don't use the prefix councillor, they're actually say a Howard.
Yeah, that's private.
But you might be revealing information that you would have only got as a councillor.
Right.
Then you might have thought, well, I've done it as a private person, but actually you effectively got information that you've got from council documents which otherwise would say they were confidential, which you would otherwise not have got. Then you're putting yourself into that area being, actually, you're a councillor again.
Yeah.
So it gets a little bit tricky. I couldn't sum it up here now in the time because it's just wouldn't be possible. There's a whole industry of it in this, but there are the guidelines are very good.
Yeah.
But, do occasionally refresh on that because I'm very active on social media. You're younger than many. but it is definitely the way of the world these days, isn't it? And yeah. there are some grey areas. It's fair to say. Put the council prefix. Yeah, most of the time you're going to be early council, but even sometimes people make a mistake putting that prefix and they're not actually a councillor. And there are cases where that's been proven. So it's interesting. It's more the issue for me is when people think they're acting as an individual, not as a councillor, but right. They might use information they would have otherwise got. That's where they get slightly caught.
And is that monitored?
It can be, it's the point. And it's not, say, by officers or fellow members, it's the general public out there watching what they do.
Okay.
They're the ones who have been made complaints. And they are watching.
Yeah, they watch, as you well know, yeah. they watch everything you do.
Yeah.
Slightest little foot out of place, people that aren't of your business persuasion will come down and you look at the number of X's you know. So you have to make sure that you are squeaky clean.
But if you haven't been squeaky clean and a member of the public picks up on it, is there something that the council will then do?
If they make a complaint, then there's a whole process that kicks in terms of how it's handled, how important it's handled. How necessary is it to actually do something about it? But there's always an initial assessment.
Okay.
And there's a judgment as to whether there's further action required or not. And then depending on what that is, there's always a role for an independent person. We've actually got through the two here tonight. There's always a role for them anyway in our arrangements because we've chosen to include them in various stages. But that potentially goes on to, if it's serious enough, to a hearing. That you don't want a hearing. No member of the council wants a hearing. Irrespective of the sanctions I was talking about earlier, it's the reputation. That's the consequence. Mm-hmm. You know what the sayings are, no smoke without fire and all that stuff. Try to avoid it if you can. Hence, be careful, but don't be inhibited. At the end of the day, social media is there as a tool. It's like a pen and paper now, or a phone, whatever. Remember the bones, and remember that you've got some information which other people wouldn't have, because you've got it from a confidential source.
As I say, if it's stuff that's generally in the papers that come to council, then that's most of the time it's going to be that, but it's things like
pin papers,
yes, pin papers,
that's
confidential information that you've got, but generally the majority of the stuff which should come up. Councillor Collins.
Yeah, thank you, sorry. Yeah, just a very quick question about predisposition and predetermination. I think you've talked with this very well when we had our very first meeting when I was first a councillor about it's one thing to have a view, but you've got to have a balance. So it's great that you can express your opinion, but you've also got to remember that you can't absolutely stand by that. You've got to allow enough process to take part and then finalise your overall opinion. And I think that's the best way of sort of summing it up. I hope that's the right way to look at it, because I think sometimes when we get involved in executive council, I'm sure that's happened in the parish as well, you do get the feeling that there is a kind of a political agenda that's very strong and particularly organised through social media platforms. And that does sometimes work its way into the council. That does concern me sometimes, because I do sit there and I do think, I wonder if that person is really that far determined to bring their view that strongly to the meeting. They've almost made up their mind. And I do wonder about the process sometimes. It's just something that does stand there. I do think we try to, or at least I do, try to take a very fair and measured view on each part or the different sides of the argument, and then try to come up with a fair perspective. But that's come through something I learned very early on, which is through that very first meeting, that try to, you can definitely, like you, every council will get elected on the things you say, because you'll stand by a statement. But you, although that's your statement, you stood by it, you sometimes have to be very careful, don't you? That's the whole point of this, about not being too rigid to it, but it affects your opinion and, you know, in a way it's biased. I hope that kind of makes sense.
Yeah, that's right. One of the principles of public life is objectivity. So, which is an interesting concept in what is a political arena. At the end of the day, we're in a political world, and local government is party to that, forcibly, obviously. So, clearly there are going to be political positions, manifestos, and all the rest of it. But, when it comes to decision making, you've got to be able to switch, if need be. Able to resist, for example, party whips, if that were applied. I don't think it's applied in this council, from my understanding anyway. But, you know, you've got to be able to fairly deal with the information that's pertinent to the decision, not necessarily the prejudice or the pre-formed view, but be able to change it. That said, you may have a pre-formed view, which you are willing to change, but you don't change it because you still see if that's appropriate. But you've got to try to be fair to all citizens, objective, so people can see you've been objective, you've gone about things in a way. Clearly, they understand, people understand that they're in the political process. So that's accepted. But it's making sure you're not so biased that you put your own ability at risk, but you also put the council's responsibility at risk.
Thank you.
Okay.
I should know the answer to this, but I don't. Per, does that apply to the parish council election?
It still covers election periods. So, but our responsibility is for DDC publications. So for us, it's.
I've never, to be honest, come across it in about 4, 5, 6 different elections. So,
be of concern, you don't tend to produce that stuff. We produce publications proper, if you like.
Yeah.
Guidebooks or whatever it might be. So.
But if we were starting a campaign against a housing development, which of course we have to be unbiased about.
It's a point that's picked up the localism act. You can still do some form of lobbying, etc. But it's a murky point.
Sounds a lovely area. Right. I always make sure I put a bit on the end saying you may have a different opinion of the government.
Yeah. But it's the PERDA guidelines are really about what the council produces. The guidelines on publicity. That's essentially what it's about.
It's so that would affect what the parish council produces.
But it's not affecting business as usual.
No, fine, okay.
Committees continue to meet.
I'll have to look into it.
It would also affect, actually, I mean, individual councillors using council email addresses for political purposes. So if you happen to have a website for your parish council.
Well, parish council is non-political, so I guess that's.
Generally, I mean, they are. I don't know whether yours is particularly political or not.
No, it's not. Actually.
Majority of them don't seem to be. Most people don't tend to do an awful lot of canvassing, as it were, for the parish council elections, as they do with districts and national elections and county. Yeah.
Okay, great. Can we move on to 4.4?
Yeah.
Okay. So, complaints handling. just to make mention here, there is the other paper on the agenda, which is effectively a schedule of the complaints, and normally we register those and acknowledge those and everything else, but I bring out the flavours from those in this particular section of the overall report. So, yes, we've got a complaints handling process in place, which seems to work in so far as we have had relatively few numbers of cases, but it seems to work. I had 8 in 2016-17 determined, and another one was awaited determination. 7 were about parish members and 2 were about district councillors. It's normal to have more parishes for the reasons I said earlier. Relatively few, which is good, and it's akin to what's happening in the county as a whole. We often have dialogue on Shinosa's meetings about whether people are put off complaining because of the sanctions limitations. Don't know. There hasn't been any research on that, but it's a possibility. The complainants' concerns largely about individual members, which is right, because that's how the conduct regime is made about individual members, about their behaviour, in particular, alluded to a disrespectful behaviour. Get quite a bit of that, and it's often difficult for people to understand, I made a complaint, so why aren't you going to do something about it? Because you'll see from the report that most of the cases have been no further action. And to be perfectly honest with you, they have not justified further action. They've not justified public money being spent on these things. And those who have been party to previous regime know, and I'll use this comparison, this phrase, it was a sledgehammer to crack a nut at times. Because you went into an automatic process which was quite time consuming, long, cost money therefore, and sometimes it was, as I say, frivolous really. We don't have that now, we have our own process and we can weed things out, and a lot of stuff needs weeding out, so they are genuinely no further action. But there is a role, as I say, for an independent person to see what's been done with some of those cases, not all of them. The initial settlements are done just by myself, but the outcome of some of those which need some further interrogation, as it were, there's a role for independent persons in particular to just see what we've done, whether they agree or not. One of the issues is about corroborative evidence. You get he said, she said quite a bit, as you can imagine. I had a complaint which was based on a telephone conversation. Well, there's absolutely no way you can verify what was said in the telephone conversation, short of confessions. I've rarely had a confession, I have to say, in all my years doing this, that I did something wrong. So nobody gets that point. And usually there's some history going on between the persons concerned, to be perfectly honest, anyway. Also, though, people don't necessarily, when they complain, why should they, understand what the code of conduct covers. So that point about acting in their capacity as a counsellor are two recent ones where, yeah, you might think there were real concerns, but the counsellor was, yes, a counsellor, but they're acting as your neighbour. And it was purely in that capacity they're acting. Nothing that I can do about it, even if I wanted to, which I didn't in particular. So that acting in official capacity is quite a substantive issue, isn't it? So I mentioned about consulting with an independent person. There was one complaint determined following investigation. There's one that's still currently in investigation mode, but the one that's determined following investigation, consultation was had with an independent person, had to concur with the investigator's conclusions, there was no breach, and my decision therefore, which was not to take the case further, the case closed. But what we do, we've done it previously with different independent persons, I think it's the right thing to do still, is we record the views of the independent person to give this sense of, look, there's been someone else looking at this, not just us. The independent persons, I can tell you, are independent-minded. So I have a problem with what they say, and they have no problem with saying what they say. And it's important to reflect that, I think, in the decision notice. I'm very keen on writing up decisions. So whilst no further action, I know some authorities, basically, it's a one-line letter goes back that says there's no further action to take in this case, thank you for your inquiry, thank you for your complaint. I tend to do a decision notice, because perhaps it's a bit stupid of me, but I quite like to set out the reasoning so people can understand what's required and what's not required, and what's appropriate and what's not appropriate. But I also use it to give some subconscious messages to perhaps the counsellor. Hang on a minute, you're a little bit close, perhaps. You might want to reflect on that. Also some subtle messages to perhaps to the clerks, the councils. Perhaps you want to think about this procedure, because it could have avoided, if it was a better procedure, it could have avoided a problem. You might want to think about that. Which we can do formally when it comes to a proper case, if you like, one of substance. But I'd like to try and do it subtly as well through writing our decision notices. What we also do is send those decision notices redacted to the members of the committee twice a year. And the next one's due fairly soon, actually. I've got a draft on my desk at the moment. To give you more detail to the schedule that comes up later, so you've got a flavour. But it doesn't, deliberately does not identify even to you as members, the parish councillors or the parish councils. Because going back to predisposition, predetermination, I wouldn't want you to think, oh, that parish council keeps going up, they must be a bad one. No, I don't want you thinking that. So you know what the issues are that come up, and you cannot work out, unless you're part of that council, you cannot work out where it is or who it is. And I think that's important. So most of the complaints have definitely been indeterminate. Not all of the complaints are, but being about councils, most of that parish, inevitably. So there have been no issues about employees. As I did say earlier, there's a role for the committee in terms of employees. Nothing in respect of appeals by employees in the past year. As a result of the no action, there's not been any hearing panel. In the past, the hearing panels have worked. But if we have a hearing panel again, we'll get some learning from that, no doubt. And it will be a good thing to go through every so often anyway to see if your members are working. But we think they worked fine. Finally, I mentioned the report that members of the committee were here last year. We know that we've been trying the last 2 years. 3 years to get the police to engage in producing a protocol with us. Monash officers of the county had tried to do it. I wasn't going to let it go, and I tried to do it from a DEC perspective because it was relevant to a case I was working on. And I got some initial hopeful noises from the police, but nothing has come through. Stephen Lodes, independent member who's not here tonight, he's also pursued it with the Police and Crime Commissioner to no avail. He's got some contact with the police. He's been given a name in the police, which is the same name I've had. I'll say again, as I said last year, quite frankly, I think the police are a lot bigger fish to fry. And I've no problem with that at all. It would be nice to have a protocol. It would be nice to have more certainty in the process. But I understand entirely why the police haven't put the resources into this. So I am not recommending to you that we pursue the police. I've not killed it. So if it does come forward, they come back with comments on the draft we put forward. Great, I'll bring it back to you. Say yeah or no, but I don't want you to expect that the police will produce because they've got bigger fish to fry. You know what's happening in the world. That's the end of that comment.
Okay. Okay. Really, comments from the page on that.
So you're sort of saying people's dissatisfaction with the outcomes and the not being any sanctions. Say out of the eight, how many of those people do you think were satisfied with what the outcome, not insofar perhaps that nothing can be done, but insofar it's been looked at? Do you think that was sufficient for some of them?
They're happy that there's been a complaint investigated. It's the outcome that becomes the issue for one or two of those eight. I can think of two.
Right.
One about district councillor.
Well, I've done that, but insofar as you've written to them, you've explained
it. Yeah, I've only had come back.
And I thought for most people, it still remains a way through to complain to somebody when they're going nowhere with the parish council, going nowhere. You know, they complain to the clerk, they complain to the councillors, nothing happens. It's still, I think, seen as a room for somebody independent to look at their complaint. And
I think they see it as objective.
Yeah.
Monitoring officers have particular roles and they are protective positions in the law. So there are three positions that authorities have. One of them is monitoring officers, where there's a special protection, they say. So to that extent, I'm quite happy to discharge that responsibility by being forthright and giving the opinion.
Yeah.
Hopefully the clerks accept that. I do get a lot of contact, so hopefully that's a good sign. So yes, I think can see it as an objective process, and I think it helps them sometimes to have.
Oh, sure, it does. It just gets up the chest, you know.
Because it's very parish level, it's very local, isn't it? It's going to be difficult to handle. the complainants themselves, are they content? I think most are content with going through the process. And only two, one of which I'm not surprised wouldn't have been happy with the outcome. Put it like that.
Thanks. Right, we're now going to move on to item 4.5, which is the independent person section, so far independent persons.
What I could say, Chair, just before we do go, there is a chunk I can deal with before we get to that particular element, and I can stop if I have
to. Okay, yeah, I'm happy with
that. Is this a separate point?
Yes, definitely. If you want to, if you want to indicate to the independent persons then at the point at which they might want to
leave. Okay. So we have a requirement to have at least one independent person. We have three, and I'm very grateful for three. We've got good people. And one of the important points is the language. It's not helpful. They are independent persons as opposed to independent members. So that can be difficult for outsiders to understand, but they are independent completely of the council, have no role on the committee or anything like that. They'd be relatively quiet, but not being absent, because I wanted them to be, one, trained, as I say, I've noticed things, but two, they've had to be deployed because we've had complaints. Sometimes, all the time, I need to, if something's going to go for a bit more assessment, I need the subject member of the complaint, for example, to have an independent person to be able to confide in and talk with, or whatever they want to do with that person, if they want to. So there's been a role for the independent person. I mentioned a case where the decision investigator got put past the investigator. As well. So there are various roles. They have attended seminars, which I would say two shows commitment, which is good. They also usefully provide feedback to me as to what those training sessions, those seminars, have identified. And we have an annual meeting to wash up on the experience of them and of ourselves as council in handling district and parish councillors. And they've got some views, which some of them which I've put in paper here. So for example, the fourth paragraph on page 13, discussion about whether an independent person should be involved in initial assessments of complaints. So this is where I get a complaint and I say, right, okay, yeah, that should go into investigation. Could be a role for informal resolution, which definitely would involve an independent person, or no further action, which essentially is going to be me deciding that. And the suggestion, which is not necessarily their suggestion, but came back from the seminars, that some do this, have the person involved at the initial assessments level, is to give political cover. But this authority, I don't believe, needs that, or doesn't need to offer me that protection, I'll put it like that. This authority does not work in that way of having any concern about the discretion of the monitor officer being affected. So I don't need, from my perspective, because it's a kind of protective device, I don't need, I feel that political cover. So I don't support. But that's interesting what happens elsewhere in some places, like I remember in some places. So that was a particular point I wanted to bring to the attention of the committee in respect to the independent person's feedback. We usually have an exchange, but we all recognise it's been a relatively quiet community. The criteria for mystery shopping was mentioned, we touched on that this evening a bit, as to whether it's better to forewarn the council of a specific visit. I can see logic in that. And as we have discussed, I can see logic in it, in the sense of why, if they get to know about it, give them the feeling they've been spied on, if you like. My trouble is, I'm trying to deal with the mystery bit of it, because I think there is value in having a mystery show, because if you do let the council know you're coming, there is, being honest, a risk of some change in behaviour, perhaps, forearmed. I think mystery shopping is a concept that works quite well. There are differences of view on this, that's the thing to say. I quite like what we do now. Those who've done mystery shopping, like one or two of you may have been spotted, I don't know who have done it. I can't go to a parish council very readily without being spotted. I did it once, and I could see straight away. Bit of whispering going on. I don't know if the meeting's behaviour changed or not, but the perception was left with me. Maybe it had. And that's the disadvantage. And I don't see it as a spying or a threat per se. I just think it's part of the promoting of good standards. It's a way we can do it by just testing what's going on there. And it was suggested that we can do it to ourselves as district council too. Yeah, no problem. Let's be upfront about it. And actually a parish council, a district council, county council, any council, shouldn't have any fear of anybody doing what's been done. It's a public meeting. So I do understand some logic, but I like the mystery element, and then get a sense of what I put near as end of a normal council meeting. But overall, those things shared, overall, the independent persons haven't seen any need for great change. But don't get them wrong or me wrong. They could do with a bit more business, they'd like a bit more business to actually practice this stuff. Because that's when they get better understanding, and we get better understanding, of course. Not just having we don't want that then. That's probably the place to pause for now and see if there's any comments and questions, and then we'll come on to the financial bit.
Any comments on
just the one obvious one, but it's, sorry, it's worth mentioning. Obviously, being involved in retail most of my life, at a senior level, if you know the visit's coming, I guarantee it's a whitewash, absolutely every time, because you forward is formed, as you say, so you know you would use that information, because it affects everything you do. It will change the behaviours of your, you know, in case of retail staff, in the case of people observing the behaviours, it's no doubt it would. So I think the mystery part's critical to this, but that continues.
I mean, I think are all parish councils aware that they run this scheme,
yeah.
So they could potentially be at any time to be shot.
Yeah.
So it's not like they're being subvertively spied on.
Yeah.
It's a snapshot.
They are aware that they can be, and as Simon has mentioned, I mean, it's a public meeting, and therefore they shouldn't have any fear at all about, they should be conducting themselves in the way that they would. We do so every time, whether or not there's any public there or any mystery shoppers there.
We put it in the key messages, and I'll propose it and say it again. I haven't had any clerk, for example, complain to me or any cancer for that matter. So I think it's not. Why do they probably didn't know? So, but they know the concept because it is set out in the key messages at the start of the year, if you like. So.
So we're at the point now that
if
you wish to leave, you don't have to. I'm not kicking you out. I'm just saying, if you wish to leave.
I do try and help them say that if you want it printed, I'll print it for you. But there is a kind of expectation that we do something like that. And at the end of the day, they are giving themselves, giving up their time to assist. And if I lost them, I would be bothered. I do not think I would lose them, as it's currently stand. But, you know, I always think you probably get one, and you only need one. I don't want one, I want more than one, because there are different roles to play, I think. Incredible to have them, well, have more than one. But what I've always struggled with, which is why I've never recommended it, I'm still not recommending it, that's for you to consider, I won't die over it, don't get me wrong, is independent person. And I'm conscious that Joe Public, or perhaps use the phrase, he pays the pipe, goes to the gym. And even though if they get some payment, it might be perceived they're not as independent as they were previously. That said, I have said in the report that other councils that I can find information about this, it's a bit hard. Probably because some of the levels are low, that don't
go into normal reporting requirements. So, for example, over £500 is quite a threshold for reporting of transactions in council accounts. But I've got some information where councils are paying a basic rate and paying expenses. One's paying basic rate but paying expenses. So I thought it was wise to bring it to you so you're aware of it, and you may decide to do something contrary to my view, because other Monster officers are quite comfortable, obviously, with other councils. My issue, as I say, was what would a member of the public think? Would they think actually lost a bit of independence? Or is it so token, frankly, it's immaterial? Why should a member of the public think like that? So hence it's a question. Please do not expect them to be knocking on your door tomorrow saying, why didn't you agree to that or whatever? They have not pushed this out. They possibly feel awkward and then decide to leave the meeting. Good on them to do that. But I leave it for you. I have not seen fit to include it, but I have said, yeah, that's for you. It's a political point about independence. The budget consequence is relatively trivial. It's the principle, whether it's the right thing to do or not. And that's more for your discussion, I suggest.
Yeah. Okay, do you want to raise any thoughts about what they think about that?
Yes,
thank
you, Chair. I think they should. I'll be honest, I think they should get an independent payment, actually. I think the reasons are very simple. I mean, we're now living in difficult times. We're asking people to do something for nothing, and that's great that they have up to this point. That's been brilliant. But you know that as times go along, it will continue to get more and more difficult to recruit. I think there's got to be a cursory payment. It is small, but it's a token of actual respect that it's there for them. At the end of the day, they don't have to accept it like all these sort of token payments. Mm-hmm. They can refuse on principle and say, no, I will remain absolute independent from the payment. I think it should have the option to be done, that's how I would view it, to allow them to put their mark or stamp on it. But quite rightly, they may have some difficulties. I mean, travelling costs and various other things have definitely increased. I can think of countless other ways that costs can be incurred. You're doing it, you know, really as a volunteer, and that's fantastic. But if there is a way, and this is a mechanism, I think we should reward it, because I would like to keep a good retention of good people. And as you say, it's always got to be fair and independent how they're chosen. That's the mechanism is there, then I don't see any issue with these numbers. They're not massive, but it causes me any great concern. But the same as if somebody was putting in a claim for travelling expenses, even if they're independent working on the committee, it's the same thing. But
I would agree with you on that point, in the sense that if we're providing travelling expenses already,
which would continue
anyway. Yeah, but if the public, potentially the public could look at that and say, well, they're still not totally dependent because you're paying the travelling expenses, aren't you?
Yeah.
And from what Simon's put forward, is it is a nominal sum that wouldn't be or shouldn't be seen as an inducement to act either way, in the favour of the council or not, you know, anything like that. So I can see where you're coming from, but also I can see what Simon's point is. Is it totally independent? But arguably, is it not totally independent now with travelling expenses, so, yeah.
No, travelling expenses surely totally different, because that's an expense that's actually incurred to attend a meeting.
Well, you could argue that.
It's not payment of any other sort. Mm-hmm. It's just to cover expenses. So £300 is essentially
it's
a
payment
for you or whatever you like, but it is a payment for them to do the job. Mm-hmm. And to me, it's neither one thing or the other. I mean, it's enough to create potential problems, it's not enough to achieve anything, as far as I can see. I really don't see the point of it.
So you're saying that you wouldn't support?
I don't support it.
Yeah. So we've got both views at the moment.
It's good. Some good topics.
Are there any other points? Would anybody else like to throw their hands to the ring and say what they think? It would be good to have a bit of a debate. As we've got one for and one against, it would be interesting to see what other members of the committee actually think before we make a decision.
I don't see a real problem in paying a small retainer of £300 a year, what you're talking about here. Have there been problems in recruiting these people? Have the turnover been high? Is there a pressure from that side to do this?
Not particularly here. I'm conscious that locally there have been issues, so I'm aware of that through dialogue with those colleagues. The previous independent persons, when I raised that, I said I raised it with the previous group, violently opposed the idea because of the independence points.
that was that group, and maybe I'm affected by that group's strong views to that extent. Is that because of us doing it? So it hasn't been to date, but it is, as I said, it is a potential concern because they don't have to. But I can't. No. Have I got anything that's going to happen? Never happen. That they're going to resign? No.
I don't personally have a problem with it, but that said, if there isn't a problem recruiting, a bit like you were saying, it's £300 is neither fish nor fowl. If they were pressing for it, or you're having difficulty getting these people, but I mean, it is a responsible position, and you do need a reasonable skill set to do it, so I suppose there is a sense that ought to be rewarded, but then you're not rewarding at a level commensurate, really. It is essentially a volunteer role.
Mm. As Simon put in his report, from the information you've gathered from other councils, it does vary. £300 is the lowest amount.
It's the lowest I've found.
Mm. So we were suggesting that. I mean, other councils suggest more, and they pay, and they have no, I suppose, issue with independence and things like that. It's not an illegal or an ultra-virus thing to do, but it's down to each councillor to decide what they want to do. I mean, I'm happy to hear everybody's views before we can. I think probably a good idea to go to possibly to a vote on it. You think? Or?
Yeah, you can do that, Joe. The only thing I have to say on that voting point is
we have the wrong book.
For that item, you'll be recommending to council the members of the council can either recommend.
Yeah,
so we can that's right. Vote. Whereas if it was a resolved item, you can.
Yeah. Catherine.
Thank you. I think I'd like to see sort of £300 used as a retainer, but for expenses to come out of that as well, just the one rather than two, just the one, because they would still get more in that way than they would if they just get expenses like they have been up to now. And I mean, looking at some of the other prices, I think they must be a lot busier than we are. Because I wouldn't have thought they'd even pay out like East North Ants from 460 to, I take it that's 1,162, there's no pound sign in front of them, plus expenses. Now, that either they're very, very busy or they're paying well over the rate that they should be. But I think with the £300, they'd be getting their expenses plus something as well out of that.
Just to confirm, Jane, my understanding is East of France are busy on the complaints front.
And more problems than us.
Well, not sure if they're called problems, but they have more issues to do.
More issues to do. Perhaps they've got a general populace that likes to complain more, possibly. I don't know.
Yeah,
I suppose perhaps we're lucky in Downing District is that people respect the local government and actually behave themselves most of the time, which is good.
Northampton, for example, don't pay expenses, but maybe because the geography of the place means if you're coming from Northampton, it's not much of a cost to deal with. I don't know. So it's difficult to give you a proper benchmark.
Are there any there's no national figures, are there, I suppose? It just depends. I mean, Daventry has always historically been quite a frugal council in respect of expenses for anybody, councillors included. Whereas other councils further down south, you go down towards the London metropolitan boroughs and things, they tend to be a very lot more generous, whatever it's called. Whereas,
and there are other councils who don't pay anything, just expenses. So we're not alone. I know that I can't give you the names of them, but I know of that. But it's a choice, basically. Mm. Valid points can be made on both sides, is there?
So can you say, so the 300 is for travel?
What's suggested here,
yeah.
if you wanted to do it, the £300 was for a retainer, for want of a better phrase, and then there would be the travel expenses. And they currently get travel expenses and subsistence if that comes to it, but they get to say a whole conference if it's not really included in the payment rate for the conference. But this is on top of that basic payment, £300 or whatever they choose for being an independent person.
It was Catherine that thought about the possibility of combining the two into a single lump sum.
That's the wondering what that would look like.
Yeah.
because when you first raised the case, everyone was thinking, okay, we did some analysis on that, and the claims that have been made in the past, say past 18 months, sound odd, but the past two lots of claims I've seen, I think the figures are like £80, £100, the max was something like £170 for a year. So that was an unusual one. It's more like £100 would be the expenses. On the current workload, one of the issues to factor in, and this is more support for the retainer idea, is if the cases did go up, and there is a case potentially it's going to be of interest in the work coming up at the moment, if that workload did increase, then again the obligation on them is perhaps more demanding than otherwise has been the case in the last year or two. So I've got to be fair about that. So there are pros and cons.
So the 300, if
they
were to merge together, they're not going to be
out of pocket. If that suggestion was taken,
The initial suggestion would be £300 plus whatever travelling expenses and subsistence that happens to be incurred. Councillor Edwin was suggesting that we might merge the two so there'd be an absolute cap of £300 irrespective. So at the moment, from Simon's figures, you've effectively got probably a £200 increase in what you would normally have. So it's a £200 plus on top of what they're paying on the back of that. That suggestion.
Can I just ask a question? Is this to be set for 1 year? If we suddenly find that everything hits the fan and they're going to be used a lot more, would we be able to increase it, or have we got to wait till the end of the year to discuss it again?
I can bring a report back through council, if you like, rather than wait for the committee. For me, the idea was to set something in train for perennial. But if there became an issue, for example, if there was no work, that might be an issue. But if there was more work, and as I was concerned, particularly where I'd lost people and I couldn't recruit people, I might well come straight back to council. My strategy would say, something. I don't think we need to call a special committee. That would seem a bit unnecessary.
Possibly.
Just the if.
But yes, quite right. Right.
Yeah. As I say, as Simon's already mentioned, that we can't make a recommendation. Well, we will make a recommendation tonight about what we think. Which we're going to cut to the full council. It's actually first then to full council.
No, we'll go to council. If you wanted to recommend a payment, that would go to council. If you didn't, just stick with what the advice is in the book, and then we know council deliberation be no need to. So if you want to choose to add to the recommendation team, because you'll see the recommendation team are all resolved items because they can be your remit as a whole. But that particular issue is for council.
So when we come to, because we will need to take a vote on the resolved items then.
Yes.
Initially, plus if we want to make a recommendation to full council about remuneration, then we can do this, but we don't have to.
Yes.
So, okay. Is there any further comments?
I just agree with the last suggestions, but also they don't have to make the claim anyway, so it's their choice, isn't it, ultimately.
That's right. I mean, it's with regard to members' expenses, they don't have to. It's set down that a member of this council will get a certain allowance, and they don't have to take up that if they don't want to.
And as a matter of course, I never claim travel expenses just out of that pure principle. I really believe in I'm trying to do, if that makes sense. And that's why I think they will have that kind of power in their mind.
My only concern with the suggestion being made is if the workload did increase, and which would need to be handled there and then, as it were, this is somewhat theoretical, but if they had a cap and yet their expenses were more than that, then they cap. Now that hurts. That's the issue I've got with that. That hurts that they're actually being asked to incur expense then, which we haven't done today. We've essentially recompensed them for actual expense. So there's a risk of that. I think it's low because I've told you the figures that I've had so far this year. But just be aware of that. So they'll have that thought as well. You know, clever people, they'll be thinking, well, hang on a minute. If they were bothered about it. I can't say to you they're bothered about it now. So I'm dealing with the theoretical bit, but just so you're aware of that, cap becomes an absolute cap. Becomes potential.
potentially in a disabling camp.
Well, we are, I suppose we are in a position that this decision, any decision we make as a committee, can be, say, amended, reviewed at any stage. But obviously, you would have to go through to, if the full council were to act on our recommendation, if we made one, then it would have to go through to the full council again. So it's not an easy decision to overturn or amend, but it can be done. So it's not, we're not putting ourselves into any political or any hot potato situation by making a recommendation.
Yes, so, I like the suggestion. I think taking on board is right and fair. But I think it's a good suggestion because obviously travel expenses, by definition, mean you have to show that you have these expenses. So you would know once people are approaching kind of the cap point. And I think there's plenty of wriggle room to say that it's a fair budget. Mm. And if you ever get to a point where it would need to be reconsidered, you probably have enough time at the moment. So Julie's got a process in place to review it up here if required.
Yeah. So the current independent persons are probably not particularly fussed about it at all, but future people, I mean, as Simon said, that we don't really think that there's going to be an issue with them suddenly resigning, and but if that were to happen, some, you know, we don't know through the personal circumstances might mean that somebody doesn't want to do it anymore, then we'd, the new people that we would agree onto the committee might have a different view. But I think the system is flexible enough for us to be able to review and if we have to in the future at any stage. But personally, my personal view is that I've got no issue either way, really, as to whether we allow them to have an expenses allowance plus a retainer or not. I mean, expenses probably covers most of the things that if they're expected to go off and incur extra cost, subsistence allowance is allowed, as you said. If they're doing a mystery shop or something, they have. And they're out for more than so many hours, potentially they can claim for subsistence on that.
Yeah.
What I understand from the, but that's unlikely to occur.
Then, I don't think they would do that. And I tend to use the independent members of the committee more than the independent persons.
Mm-hmm.
To be perfectly honest. I used one because there was some relevance, but usually it's the independent members of the committee too.
Yeah, so we're not talking about anything else. But, I mean, if anybody wants to, I mean, we've had a good debate about it, we've got everyone's views. Is there anybody that wants to put forward a proposal that we put any recommendation of any sort to council? Don't have to, I mean.
For the DVC members.
For the DVC members, I'm talking, yeah.
Well, if you put a proposal, I'm
yes,
sure.
Yes,
I know. Okay, so if you want to put forward a proposal, are you suggesting the proposal you had earlier on about saying we a £300 fee, a one-off fee, and that would include all expenses and subsistence.
Yeah.
And that is claimable.
Just a straightforward proposal like that, I think.
An annual.
Yeah.
Not a one-off thing.
Yeah. A once-off fee of £300, irrespective of how much expenses are incurred within that year.
As long as I asked if there was any chance, if it did go above that, because we were very, very busy, whether we could look at it. That proposal of £300 a year, sort of unless that we have put any proposal as well.
Yeah, well, I've written down here the potential, if there was a proposition, a potential way of expressing it, one of which your suggestion now is annual payments be made to independent persons of £300, which shall include travel and subsistence expenses. What you could do, think about it, is you could say you can claim the £300 if you want, or you can separately claim just for your expenses.
Well, yeah.
And the expectation that the expenses are going to be lower anyway, having date. So that could be something you could choose on. So that's just another variation. Sorry to confuse it a bit, but that's another variation. So you give them, I just go back to the point made earlier, what if they thought, hang on, if the work did suddenly increase, and you couldn't come back in time to get an agreement, or the council didn't agree, that's a risk.
well, you've capped us now. I don't know if I want to risk that. I'm not interested anymore. So that's just this hypothetical to a large extent, but so I just want you to be aware of
it. Are you suggesting, Simon, that at the beginning of every fiscal year or whatever, you would make a choice about what you wanted to do for that year?
They can choose.
Rather, because I'm thinking if you've got somebody that's going halfway through the year and suddenly realising, well, I'm going to be out of pocket yet, I'll contact you and say, actually, I want to carry on paying expensive only, even though they're claiming 300. But if they've claimed, or they're nominated to you, they want to claim 300, they can't change their mind throughout the year. But if they decide that they're not going to take that, they can put a claim for expenses.
Because some of them might have the problem of, I don't want to be seen to be paid by the council in that direct way.
It's just that the amounts that you have quoted that people have put in for expenses, the 300 will, if everything stays the same, there's no real reason why we should really get a lot more work for them. I think we do very well. So really, the £300 is going to be more than they've been getting in expenses anyway.
If it was as per this year, last year, they have been quieter this year. And I would expect it to go up a bit. But can I tell you how much? No, but I know there's one case which will take up a bit of time, I think. So, but you just don't know what's going to come through the door, you see, in terms of complaints. I don't know what's coming next. Well, I've had two investigations this year. So, yeah.
If you had, so it's quiet this year, but have you had a chance to look at expense claims for the year? This is the 18 months.
Yeah, so I've got two sets of information. It seems to be 18 months for some. That's what it's essentially saying, is that sort of amount. Previous year I haven't got, but I'm trying to give you more current information, if you like.
Councillor Howard.
I just want to say that I quite like the wording that Simon said about one or the other. I prefer that wording. Because I feel like we're acting on what's happened in the past 18 months, and we've got the ability to change that. If it's not working in like a year's time or something, we can change the decision. But I prefer the wording that you said.
Right, so you can choose either.
Because they'll never be deemed as out of pocket, and if they are starting to be out of pocket, and it's not working, and then we're at risk of losing them, we have that ability to change it.
So we probably want them to nominate at the beginning of the year whether or not they wanted to take the 300, and if they said they didn't want to take that, they can still carry on claiming their expenses, irrespective of what they come.
So did they get 80 or?
Yeah.
Yeah.
As your proposer, Councillor Redman, did you want to accept that amendment, or do you want to put forward your proposal as you said before and take a vote on that?
Can you read out what you've got down?
Okay. Both versions so far, or do you want just your version? Do both.
Well, yes, because I'm getting a bit confused here, because to begin with, I mentioned that two other people agreed with it.
You've definitely got a seconder, Councillor Collins.
And then this gentleman said.
But you haven't voted on it.
No, I know you haven't.
So that's still out there.
Well, perhaps you want to have a vote before you actually put this together, then, in case somebody wants something altogether different.
I'll tell you what two versions I've got on the back of your suggestion and Dr. Howard's suggestion now.
Okay.
So your version would be something like annual payments be made to independent persons of £300, which shall include travel and subsistence allowances. Mm-hmm. The alternative version would be annual payments be made to independent persons of £300 as an alternative to travel and subsistence allowances. I've put comments, should independent persons so choose. Them to choose one or the other. That's that suggestion there.
Yeah.
So that's the distinction.
So is that something they would have to decide, each individual person, as they start their year?
Yeah.
Or if they find they're up to the 300, they can suddenly change?
That's what I would think. I mean, as you start your year, or as and when anything is introduced, they can make a decision at that point. Do they want to take their £300? And be then bound by the fact that they can't claim anything else at all for that year. Or if they don't, if they fail to make a decision, you would then deem them as not having made a decision and therefore expenses rather than allowance. So I suppose by default, that they don't make a decision by a particular time, you just assume that they would wish to continue claiming expenses.
Yeah. Okay.
So
we
haven't got a second for that then.
No, hang on. So,
just clarify what it was.
Do you wish, Councillor, do you want, I'll second for the amendment. So we've got a seconder for that amendment. So we can then take it back to the original proposal and say, well, would you be prepared to amend your proposal to include the withdrawal?
Can we just have two votes on the different proposals?
Or we can have.
Take amendment first then.
Okay, so it's only Devonshire District Council members that are allowed to vote on this, unfortunately. So we've taken your views into consideration, and we're going to have a vote now with three councillors there. And obviously, I have a casting vote here. If it's tied, then it won't be, because there'll be either three or maybe two and one. So, okay.
So this is for the amended suggestion.
This is for the amended suggestion that Councillor Howard's put forward and I seconded, that it will be an either or. So you can have £300 and you can nominate that you want to claim £300, and that would include everything, including your expenses. Or you can nominate all, probably. Don't nominate, then you'll be deemed to be accepting that you'll carry on taking expenses plus subsistence up to, not technically, or no limit, depending on what the role actually presents to you. So on that basis, then we have a vote on that. Who's in favour of that?
Yes.
Oh.
Yes, because it makes sense. It's the amendment.
I thought you said councils, wouldn't it?
So that's the amendment, which will be either or. So, can we have a
just a vote on
whether that...
Sorry, I'm having problems hearing at the back here, so
right. So what we're voting on at the moment is if an either-or proposal, which is it's different to what you initially put forward.
So you are now voting on the amendment.
Not on your original proposal.
No, okay then.
So the amendment is... Okay, that's three, that's unanimous.
Yep.
So we would then put forward a recommendation then to the full council that we feel that independent persons should be allowed to claim an allowance. Would we call it an allowance? Or a...
I've just called it annual payment.
An annual payment of £300 to include expenses and subsistence, or they can continue to claim expenses and subsistence. They reserve the ability not to claim anything at all if they don't want to, so they don't get paid for expenses. So I want to put forward a recommendation then to council.
The amendment is carried. That's the substantive proposition, technically, you're supposed to say, okay, any more amendments? But there aren't really going to be any anymore.
Yeah.
So that's the motion. That's carried through. Thank you.
Okay.
So what I've written down is before, just to clarify, annual payments be made for independent persons of £300 as an alternative to traveller and subsistence expenses, should independent persons so choose. That's the thrust of it. If you're happy to give us a little bit of license to I'd point out the difference in council it would be, but I think that would probably suffice. Okay, right. Good.
Okay, thank you. All right, so we're moving on to, I suppose, now our technical, on to section 5.
Yes.
If you want, is anything further you want to add?
No.
There's a point in further debate needed probably on the rest of the things.
No, it just gives you a little bit more structured assessment of the complaints and what's happened with them, and I sometimes put in the comment section bits that I don't put in the main report, just give a little bit of wording. But as I said, you will get redacted versions of the decision notices anyway, you'll get a lot more information. But there you go, we've got a handy summary should you need it of what's happening.
Right, so we are
basically noted, Chairman.
Yeah, just a note. the record of complaints. Of course, that's SC05-16.
Yes.
If everyone's happy to this. Sorry, I made a mistake on that list. That was last. Item number five.
Item five is right.
It's not SCO five, but that's so it is item five.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah. And then we can move on to item six, which is any urgent business. Okay, so I can prove that we meeting is now at an end at 22:08.